In the mid-1950s, as the Cold War escalated, the Royal Air Force sought a new aircraft, leading to one of the most ambitious aviation projects in British history, the BAC TSR-2. Designed to fly at supersonic speeds, carry a diverse array of weaponry, and operate from short, rough airfields, the TSR-2 would reposition Britain as a leader in aerial warfare. From its conception, the TSR-2 showcased British innovation, featuring advanced avionics for navigation and mission management, including an autopilot system for low-altitude, high-speed flights. However, the journey to its maiden flight was fraught with challenges, engine failures, bureaucratic infighting, and soaring costs. Despite its potential, the TSR-2 never reached full production, yet its legacy endures, captivating aviation enthusiasts and sparking debates about its capabilities. Some claim it was poised to break the Mach 2 barrier, pushing the boundaries of flight technology. But how close did this ambitious project truly come to revolutionizing aerial combat? In the early stages of the Cold War in the mid-1950s, the increasing sophistication of air defense systems led the Royal Air Force to consider a new aircraft to replace the English electric Canberra, which was becoming obsolete. As such, in the fall of 1957, the Ministry of Supply released General Operational Requirement 339, or GOR 339. This requirement was ambitious for the technology of the day, calling for an all-weather, long-range, low-level penetrator capable of delivering nuclear or conventional bombs with high-altitude, supersonic dash capability. It also needed to perform photo reconnaissance and electronic reconnaissance and operate from rough, short airfields. Simultaneously, around the world, similar aircraft were being developed, such as the American General Dynamics F-111 Aardvark and the Soviet Sukhoi Su-24. In the 1960s, the contract for the TSR-2 was awarded to an association of three companies, English Electric, Vickers Armstrong, and Bristol. This collaboration, which formed the British Aircraft Corporation, BAC, was notable for uniting former rivals. Despite early tensions, especially when Vickers Armstrong was named the prime contractor, the project moved forward, and BAC received a contract for 11 TSR-2 aircraft. Because it was being built by two companies, the first model's front half was designed and built by Vickers and the rear half by English Electric, which was located well over 200 miles apart. Despite the risky arrangement, when the two halves finally came together in March 1963, they miraculously fit perfectly. A total of 23 BAC TSR-2 strike and reconnaissance aircraft were made in various degrees of completion, with only a single finished model. The aircraft, which measured 89 feet in length, had a wingspan of 37 feet and enough space for a two-person crew. It featured a tubular fuselage design with a pointy nose, painted in anti-flash white paint, a specific color designed to reflect the intense heat and light of a nuclear explosion, which was a detail common to nuclear bombers of the era. This model came with small shoulder-mounted delta wings, with downturned wingtips for stability at low speeds. The wings featured full-span leading-edge slats and trailing-edge flaps for optimal aerodynamic efficiency, supporting both high-speed performance and stable low-level flight. Additionally, a boundary layer control system used high-speed air from the engines blown over the wings to enhance lift and improve low-speed handling. Its true powerhouse came with the engines, a duo of cutting-edge Bristol Siddeley Olympus reheated turbojets that gave the TSR-2 exceptional thrust, enabling it to reach impressive speeds, especially for that time period. According to the flight envelope diagram, the aircraft could sustain a cruise speed of Mach 2.05 at altitudes between 37,000 and 51,000 feet, and even achieve a dash speed of Mach 2.35. The sleek aerodynamic profile of the TSR-2 was further enhanced by the strategic positioning of its air intakes within the fuselage. This model's versatility as a strike and reconnaissance platform was further emphasized by its substantial payload capacity. The internal weapons bay could accommodate up to 10,000 pounds of ordnance, while external hardpoints offered additional payload options. This flexibility allowed the TSR-2 to carry a wide array of weaponry, including both nuclear and conventional munitions. The cutting-edge design of the TSR-2 wasn't limited to its exterior. It also had advanced technology and systems that set it apart from its contemporaries. When finished, the BAC TSR-2 was to be equipped with some of the most advanced technology of its time. a pioneering fly-by-wire control system replaced traditional mechanical controls with electronic systems, significantly enhancing handling and responsiveness. Sophisticated electronic countermeasures, ECM, such as radar jammers and chaff dispensers, helped the aircraft evade enemy detection and missile systems. Advanced ejection seats designed to safely eject the crew at high speeds and altitudes were fitted in the TSR-2, incorporating innovations that improve survival chances during emergencies. Furthermore, an automatic fuel transfer system maintained the aircraft's center of gravity as fuel was consumed, ensuring optimal balance and stability throughout the flight. Once in the skies, state-of-the-art avionics for navigation and mission management, including an innovative autopilot system that allowed for long-distance, low-altitude flights with reduced pilot workload, further distinguished this aircraft from its contemporaries. With these groundbreaking innovations, which were ahead of their time and have since become standard in modern military aircraft, the TSR-2 was poised to re-energize Britain's weakened role as a world leader in aviation upon entering service. However, all this cutting-edge technology also made it extremely expensive, somewhat problematic, and the largest aircraft project in Britain to date. Throughout the TSR-2's development, debates raged within the aviation industry and the Ministry of Defense about the future of bombers. Defense Minister Duncan Sandys argued for ballistic missiles over manned combat aircraft, while senior RAF officials believed the TSR-2 could be revolutionary, replacing the Canberra and the entire strategic bomber fleet. The program faced significant delays due to engine and landing gear issues. In February 1964, an engine exploded during a ground test, causing a 3-month delay for the first prototype. Pre-flight tests progressed slowly, with engineers working around the clock. With the 1964 election looming and the Labour Party, who opposed the program, poised for victory, the project faced political pressure. With this, the engineers turned to Roland B. Beeman, a highly decorated test pilot, to perform the first flight despite engine safety concerns. On September 27, 1964, Beaumont prepared to take the TSR-2 prototype on its maiden flight from Boscombe Down, Amesbury, Wiltshire. The aircraft faced numerous technical issues, including the risk of engine failure and malfunctioning landing gear. Despite these challenges, Beaumont did not hesitate, and the aircraft took to the sky. The engines held together as Beaumont guided the aircraft through its first minutes of flight, completing 2 wide circuits at an altitude of 7,000 feet. Beaumont was impressed by the aircraft's exceptional handling qualities. However, the fun was short-lived. As the TSR-2 touched down, a violent vibration in the landing gear, so powerful it made the pilot dizzy, nearly sending the aircraft out of control. Thankfully, the vibrations subsided and Beaumont deployed the drag chute, bringing the TSR-2 to a safe stop. Though the flight lasted a mere 14 minutes, this maiden voyage was a significant milestone. Following the first flight of the BAC TSR-2, the aircraft was grounded for engine replacements and landing gear repairs. During this maintenance period, a political storm unfolded. The new Labour government, led by Prime Minister Harold Wilson and Defence Minister Dennis Healey, won the election. Speculation arose that an unofficial deal was struck during a visit to the United States. Britain would cancel the TSR-2 in exchange for U.S. support for an $8.4 billion loan from the International Monetary Fund. This would push the Royal Air Force to adopt the American F-111 Aardvark instead. Despite the political turmoil, the TSR-2 flew again on December 31, 1964. However, it continued to face persistent vibrations and landing gear malfunctions. Yet there were moments of triumph. During Flight 14, the TSR-2 achieved Mach 1 on dry power alone, demonstrating its supercruise capability. Beaumont then engaged a single reheat unit, outpacing the Chase English Electric Lightning, Britain's fastest aircraft, piloted by Wing Commander James Jimmy Dell. Dell later remarked that the TSR-2 handled like a big lightning. Over 6 months, the TSR-2 completed 24 test flights, with test pilots praising its basic flying qualities. However, the complex electronics were not yet fitted, and these achievements were not enough to save the program. On the morning of April 6, 1965, the second TSR-2 prototype was scheduled to make its maiden flight. However, before it did so, a faulty fuel pump needed replacement, prompting test pilot Jimmy Dell to take a lunch break at a nearby social club in Amesbury. As he sat in the club, a television tuned to the Chancellor of the Exchequer's annual budget speech delivered some shocking news. The TSR-2 program was canceled by the government. Dell rushed back to the airfield, but it was too late. Despite the aircraft being ready to take to the skies, the Air Ministry had already impounded it. Baez's plea for a limited test flight program for the two flyable prototypes was rejected by the Air Ministry, especially after the project's final price tag was revealed, an equivalent of $21.2 billion in 2024 dollars. By then, the mission for the TSR-2 had become obsolete as NATO shifted focus from nuclear Armageddon to measured responses to Warsaw Pact hostility. This change in strategy required aircraft with vastly different capabilities than the TSR-2, such as the multi-role F-4 Phantoms, low-level strike Blackburn Buccaneers, and versatile V-Stall Hawker Siddeley Harriers, all of which the Royal Air Force either already possessed or was developing at the time. In the aftermath of the cancellation, the RAF was left with only one plane that had flown several times, another that was on the verge of flying, and a handful of uncompleted production prototypes. The two finished aircraft were quickly scrapped or used as target practice, and all but two of the unfinished prototypes met the same fate, with some ending up as static displays in museums. Everything else associated with the project tools, assembly facilities, plans, and design documents was destroyed as if the TSR-2 had never existed. Countless people lost their jobs. Ironically, Britain also abandoned its plan to buy F-111 ETA from the United States due to their escalating costs, which surpassed those of the TSR-2. It wasn't until 1980 that the RAF finally acquired an aircraft somewhat comparable to the TSR-2, the Panavia Tornado. Developed jointly by Britain, Germany, and Italy, the type became a mainstay of the Royal Air Force. Although never developed beyond the prototype stage, the BAC TSR-2 remains one of the most controversial British combat aircraft designs in history. To this day, some continue to argue that its cancellation was a mistake bordering on treason, while others believe it was justified given the high cost of the project and the ever-changing strategic environment. Certain experts suggest that the true tragedy was not the TSR-2's cancellation, but that it hadn't been canceled years earlier, before so much money and effort had been wasted, believing that the aircraft should have remained flying as pure research vehicles, contributing to the British aerospace industry as a whole. Nearly 60 years later, conspiracy theories still surround the TSR-2's demise. Some speculate that Prime Minister Harold Wilson was secretly a communist and axed the project at the Soviets' behest, while others suggest that of sinister United States efforts to sabotage the TSR-2 program because it outclassed any aircraft they could ever build. According to aviation historian Frank Barnett Jones, quote, "There was little doubt that America would have a definite interest in seeing the British aviation industry reduced to such a level of ineffectiveness that it would be unable to continue in its present structure." The TSR-2's 14th flight, which achieved a Mach 1.2 dash and surpassed the Lightning aircraft chasing it, has contributed to its somewhat elusive and exaggerated reputation. However, retellings of this event often omit the fact that the Lightning pilot had shut down one of his two engines to conserve fuel and did not use afterburners. Still, because of this brief Mach 1.2 dash, the TSR-2, with advanced avionics and, most importantly, its powerful Bristol Siddeley Olympus reheated turbojet engines, has gone down in history as easily a Mach 2 aircraft, despite never having the opportunity to demonstrate its capabilities fully. However, the overall consensus is that the TSR-2 was simply too advanced for its time, a groundbreaking design that fell victim to a series of unfortunate political and economic circumstances.